they are not able to do so because they have to maintain a minimum balance. So if a facility of zero balance account is extended to all, it would be in the interest of students. And as Comrade Priyadarshini has also mentioned, that bank charges, again, bank charges, we feel that bank charges are a way to appropriate surplus or appropriate this profit from the lower rung of depositors instead of going after the bigger corporate interests. This the function of bank charges becomes a function of expropriating surplus from the common people, the lowest rung of depositors, as I have mentioned. However, the major issue that I would like to talk about at some length, but I'll keep it brief, knowing that there are time constraints, is of course the credit for education issue, the student loan issue. Now, ideally, there should not be an institution, any institution of student loans, because education being a necessity should be free, universal, accessible to the highest degree possible. I mean, that is how it should be under ideal conditions. But unfortunately, we do not live under ideal conditions, and the materiality of this, of the capitalist system that we live in, have made education loans a necessity. The initial idea when education loans were being promoted and the agenda for education loans was being talked about or discussed was that the free market, the neoliberal idea, was that education loans would bring in a certain kind of equality, because anybody who is not able to afford higher education or privatized higher education can simply take out a loan. But now we know, and I mean, it is pretty obvious, that instead of promoting equality, education loans have been responsible for further exacerbating the already present inequalities and consolidating the already present class imbalances within the society, because education loans are being availed by students who already possess collateral wealth, belong to well-off financial backgrounds, and students who actually need those kinds of loans, underprivileged students often do not get because of these constraints, because of a constraint of collateral, because of a constraint of not belonging to a wealthy family, because of a constraint of not having a decent and a constant source of income. So, and apart from that, the question also arises that when the question of financing education for students comes up, a question arises: who exactly is this global banking system supposed to serve? As Mr. Raghunathan was also saying about the supposed dehumanization of entrepreneurs, similarly, students who avail for these loans undergo a similar dehumanization. Their desires, their pursuits of pursuing higher education become subservient to the tunes of global imperial capital. I mean, it's as simple as that. And we all know that education loans, as the banking sector provides, especially the private sector, it creates divides along class lines, caste lines, gendered lines, but also it creates a new kind of a divide between course lines. For example, not all courses would have a chance of availing the amount of credit, a similar amount of credit. Professional courses, which apparently have a greater market value, like engineering, medical, management, these courses generally tend to, students applying for these courses generally tend to be able to avail credit more easily than students who are trying to pursue their higher education in social sciences, languages, or humanities in general. So, because apparently those courses are not deemed profitable or lucrative from the free market point of view. So another kind of a divide is created on the basis of the courses and the basis of the streams that are being chosen by the students. And most recently, we have seen just a few days back, the new education policy as has been passed. The new education policy is constantly pushing towards a greater, a rampant privatization of educational spaces. Now, we all know that this privatization would result, I mean, would directly result in fee hikes, in increasing the cost of education that will be available to the students. So this increasing fee hike would obviously push students towards demanding more educational loans. So the demand for education credit would go up. But at the same time, as we have been observing for the past few years, the supply for education loans has been decreasing. It has gone down 3.5 percentage points year on year basis in 2019. The supply has been decreasing because of risk averseness and because of the fact that we have entrenched ourselves into a recessionary situation and unemployment is rampant, employment is uncertain. The supply of loanable education funds have been declining, but the privatization of educational institutions would push students towards demanding it more. So there develops a contradiction. A possible consequence of this contradiction could be an increase in the prices of these educational loans, an increase in the interest rates of these educational loans, which would result in fewer and fewer students being able to afford, being able to acquire these loans. And not just fewer students, but students belonging to a particular class, an upper class or an upper middle class would be able to afford these loans, be able to avail these loans. And a prime example that is often being given by the banking sector to not extend more supply of credit in the education sector is apparently because education sector leads to a considerable growth in the already high proportion of NPAs, the non-performing assets that we have. But again, this hypothesis does not stand ground in face of empirical evidences. I mean, that has been quite less. Apart from that, a general complaint from the students community is being that the accounting practice of education and NPAs, education in terms of an NPA, is incorrect in certain senses. And if it was correctly done, then one report points out that 75% of the bad education debts that are a part of the NPA would turn out to be good. One example of this is that the private banks that provide educational loans are subject to a receipt of some amount of a subsidy from state and central governments. Now, more often than not, these subsidies are delayed. These subsidies are not present. And this non-repayment of subsidy is added or accounted in the non-repayment of the students' amount of the NPA. So the blame is put on the students, where actually the default is on the part of the governments, whether they are state governments or whether they are central governments. And apart from that, yeah, pretty much NPAs do not pose such an exaggerated problem as has been told to us time and again, that these will be increasing than that. In terms of history of the World Bank, ever since 1986 has formalized and manifested its agenda to, if the usual rhetoric that if a country has to forge a path of development, then it has to A, privatize all education institutions, and the question of financing this education arises, which is then met by what the World Bank and the WTO call a market-based credit system, which is nothing but an extension of how credit is being used in all other commodities to the education sector. But we need to understand that the education sector is not a commodity. It is not essentially a commodity. It is not a profit-making enterprise. It is a public good. And recently, it has been seen that, as I've already mentioned, that the supply of loans for the education sector have been declining. Another basic problem that most of the students encounter is that for the education loans under rupees 4.5 lakhs, there is no requirement of either a third party guarantee or a collateral. But in many cases, the bank officers or the bank managers often demand these collaterals, often demand these personal guarantees, even though it is not mandated to do so. So we need to make this education loan system more borrower friendly, to humanize students again, so that they are not trapped into this vicious cycle of repaying debts even when they're old. And the timeline for repayment needs to be extended. The current timeline is around 5 to 7 years, which is the completion of education plus 1 or 2 years of your job. And we all know that the situation of job market is so that initial wages or initial salaries are not so high, and a report says that on an average the EMIs that the students have to pay have been higher than the monthly incomes that they have been receiving. The major contradiction that still develops is again the same factor, that this recent NEP, the new education policy, which pushes forth for a privatization, would lead to an increasing demand for student loans, but in a situation of a decreasing supply, very few students would actually be able to get these loans. And apart from that, what this would obviously result in is our students dropping out, not just dropping out, but being pushed out of the system of wanting to pursue higher education. Because of this burden of debt, they would prefer to just instantly get employed or further this neoliberal agenda of making developing countries a cheap labor hub and discouraging students from actually pursuing higher education, which is in fact a system of de-skilling. All this talk about skilling and a situation like this develops, which immediately results in de-skilling. It is an obvious contradiction. So immediate reforms, a system overhaul needs to be done. And a public sector bank needs to be public, as has been mentioned by the panelists, that the imagination of a public sector bank is not that it is a profit-making enterprise, but the imagination is that it provides credit to sectors which are structurally integral to the development of the economy, which promote an equitable growth. That has been the imagination of the public sector banks, and that needs to be there again. And another suggestion that comes from the students is that maybe if banks could dedicate specialized branches for providing education loans, a more human touch to these students, that would be better. So yes, the time is near, so I'd like to end with that only.